Let's start with a simple fact. Cheetos are delicious. But while that heavenly blend of cornmeal, vegetable oil, monosodium glutamate, and yellow number 6 might be hard to resist, it's probably not making your body as happy as it is your taste buds. And that's because Cheetos, Fritos, Oreos, Jell-Os, SpaghettiOs, and pretty much every other snack that ends in an O have been heavily processed. And from what we can tease out of a bunch of messy data, that category of food appears to be pretty bad for you. Which is a problem, because they make up, what number do you think I'm gonna say right now? More than half. More than half of the average American diet. But what is it about these ultra-processed foods that's causing health problems? As it turns out, the answer to that question is way more complicated than the ingredient list on your bag of cheese-flavored corn puffs. One of the things that makes determining the health risks of processed foods so sticky and gooey and crunchy is that it's hard to define what processed means in the first place. The first step is understanding all the ways foods can be processed. Even something as simple as chopping up a strawberry or roasting a potato counts as processing. But processing includes lots of other things. You got pasteurization, canning, jerkifying. But generally, foods are categorized as minimally processed, processed, or ultra-processed. Minimally processed foods, or MPFs, are just that. They are minimally processed. Not much has happened to them between the farm and table. And what does happen to them tends to be a physical change rather than a chemical one. Chopping and cooking food are examples of minimal processing, so those sliced strawberries would count as MPFs. But many foods have been more than minimally processed before they get to us. Processed foods are those that have been manipulated from what grows in nature, often using chemicals on top of that physical processing. For example, bacon isn't a pig. It came from a pig, but it was sliced and cured and treated with preservatives. Similarly, a prepackaged smoothie isn't fruits and veggies. It probably includes fruits and veggies, but they've been peeled and pulverized and preserved and combined with other ingredients like milk or yogurt. But if bacon comes from a pig and smoothies comes from fruit, where do Fruit Loops come from? Like Cheetos, they are an example of ultra-processed foods, or UPFs. This category also includes stuff like ready-made meals, instant noodles, and candy. And let's not forget ultra-processed drinks like Kool-Aid, soda, or energy drinks. Preservatives, emulsifiers, and synthetic dyes can figure heavily in UPFs. But while understanding what goes into processed and ultra-processed foods is one piece of the puzzle, understanding why certain foods are processed can give us even more clarity on how processing can affect food and the bodies it goes into. Sometimes, processing can make food healthier. Cooking and fermentation can make certain foods more nutritious because processing makes nutrients accessible. For example, your body is going to be able to pull more vitamins from cooked asparagus than from raw. Processing can also make some foods safer. Pasteurization and natural preservatives like salt allow food to travel longer distances and stay shelf stable. Freeze drying increases shelf life and preserves nutrients and antioxidants. Also on the safety front, fermenting stuff like milk and soy can make them less dangerous for people who are allergic. Polishing certain grains can also reduce fungal toxins, making them safer for consumption. And sometimes, nutrients are added to processed foods to make them even better for you, a process known as fortification. For example, sometimes vitamin D is added to milk or iodine to salt. Most of these examples would be considered processed rather than ultra-processed, thanks to that end goal of maintaining as much nutritional value as possible. But the impetus for ultra-processing is not quite so noble. UPFs are an incredibly lucrative business for food companies. To start with, they are cheaper to manufacture, mostly because synthetic ingredients can be cheaper than natural ones. And because many UPFs don't require refrigeration, they're easier to transport and store as well. But to top this all off, they are very popular with consumers, for a couple of reasons. They're super convenient, for one thing. Many UPFs are ready to eat off the shelf or need just a quick stint in the microwave, much easier than cooking from scratch. And grabbing a ready-to-go meal is often cheaper than purchasing ingredients and doing it yourself. Plus, UPFs are really tasty, thanks to added flavor enhancers. All that food coloring makes them look tempting too. But ultra-processed foods have a pretty well-documented downside. They are linked with a variety of health risks. But before we get into it, we gotta take a quick ad break.
This SciShow video is supported by ACT, the number one taken college admissions test in nearly half of US states based on 2024 grad class data. And if you're wondering why so many students take the ACT, think about the choices they offer you to test your preferred way and get your best score possible. You can take it online or on paper and with or without science questions. Plus, you can try out real ACT questions beforehand at quizme.act.org. The enhanced ACT also gives you the shortest test time yet, with 44 fewer questions, which means more time per question and less stress. You can learn more about the ACT or register for the next upcoming test at act.org/scishow, the QR code, or the link in the description.
To start, before we get to the risks of eating UPFs, a reminder that correlation doesn't equal causation. So even though we can see correlations between eating UPFs and various negative health outcomes, there could be other contributing factors here. Like if I'm chowing down on some Cheetos because I'm stressed out and don't have time to prepare anything else, it can be hard to tell if my raised blood pressure is due to my stress, my snack habit, or some other factor entirely. It's also tricky to determine whether it's actually the ultra-processing that's the problem, or high levels of sugar and salt and saturated fats that these foods tend to have. But we can use meta-analyses to compare lots of different studies on UPFs, pretty much all of which report certain health risks associated with them. These meta-analyses of observational studies have found correlations between UPF consumption and hypertension, kidney disease, depression, anxiety, poor sleep, some cancers, premature aging, cardiovascular disease, type 2 diabetes, and obesity. There's also what appears to be an association between UPFs and overall mortality, meaning the more UPFs you eat, the more likely you are to literally die. The thing is, these studies can't answer how UPFs have these effects, and they can't exclude those confounding variables. For that, you'd need controlled conditions, so you could run an experiment that strictly assesses UPFs versus non-UPFs, no other variables, which we can't do using humans. And so you know where this is going. Yep, we're gonna talk a bunch about rats. A study of UPF consumption in young rats and mice showed it decreased bone density, slowed skeletal growth, and led to fatty liver disease. In another study, UPF-fed mice had higher weight gain, gut inflammation, and even changes in brain metabolism. And previous studies have shown mice on a high-fat, high-sugar diet are more prone to diabetes, though it's arguable whether this is representative of UPFs per se. Rodent studies have also been used to evaluate the effects of particular additives that UPFs often contain. And they found the consumption of common emulsifiers led to gut inflammation, higher rates of inflammatory bowel disease, and disrupted the gut microbiome. In one study from Spain, researchers fed the emulsifier to mouse moms during gestation and found that it had negative effects on their offspring's cognition and metabolism. And some specific color additives have been shown to be carcinogenic or toxic in mice. Of course, one thing we know for sure is that rodents aren't people, and their nutrition needs and regular chow are not the same as ours, so the data shouldn't be overinterpreted. Still, it's data, and there is definitely unhealthy stuff in some UPFs. But actually, it isn't only the content of these foods we should be worrying about, but also just the amount we're consuming. Some people argue that UPFs are literally addictive, meaning they cause compulsive use and mood-altering effects. And we're not just talking about overeating because the food tastes so good thanks to all the added sugars and salts. Addiction is a different level, characterized by craving and loss of control. Studies on UPFs have found changes in dopamine sensitivity and withdrawal symptoms related to high consumption of these foods. If UPFs are truly addictive, it's not clear whether it's a behavioral addiction, like gambling, or a substance use disorder, like smoking, though scientists are leaning toward the latter. Exactly why this would be is still a little bit of a mystery, though. It could be that they have less fiber than whole foods and are easier for the gut to absorb, meaning they hit your body faster and harder, but this is all still being investigated. Either way, the seemingly addictive nature of UPFs may have been deliberate. Both Kraft and General Foods, which are large food suppliers responsible for UPFs, ETFs, such as Jell-O and Lunchables, were once owned by Philip Morris. Yes, the same Philip Morris that makes Marlboro cigarettes. The leaders of that company at the time admitted to using the same techniques to promote addiction to foods that they used for tobacco, things like enhancing flavor and texture and visual appeal. So maybe it's not so much of a surprise that it can be hard to eat ultra-processed foods in moderation. As I mentioned, the average U.S. consumer gets more than half of their daily calories from them, according to a 2010 study, and that trend seems to be only increasing. All that said, you don't necessarily have to chuck all your Cheetos straight into the trash to live a healthy life. There is so much more that is left to be studied when it comes to UPFs. We need more research to know exactly what is behind these correlations. Not to mention the fact that I'm not a doctor or a food scientist, so you should always consult your real doctor for advice on your health and take all of this with a grain of salt. But not too much salt, and not mixed with sugar and fat. That's not ideal. So definitely it is smart to be mindful about how many UPFs you're eating, and where you can, it's a good idea to take the path of less processed. But of course, we're not here to shame you for your love of breakfast cereal, boxed mac and cheese, ramen noodles, or any of those other tasty and convenient UPFs. The most important thing when you grab a bite to eat is to be informed so you can make conscious decisions, because knowledge is sweeter than anything you'll find in the snack aisle.